Now, let us proceed to the next example, very familiar example, the flow between two parallel plates, the top plate set in motion, which is a planar couette flow. We have solved the velocity profile earlier, but now what is that we are going to do? We are going to take the two plates to be at two different temperatures. Earlier we had the two plates, the top plate was set in motion, but we never even talked about the temperature, because we are focusing on the Navier-Stokes equation, our attention was on the velocity profile. But now we are considering a case where the top plate is moving, bottom plate is stationary, but now there are two different temperatures. Bottom plate is at T naught, top plate is at TH, this is at a higher temperature than this plate. Now, what is the application? We said the flow between the two parallel plates approximates flow between two coaxial cylinders, and that happens in a viscometer or in a shaft bearing. And by considering the two plates to be at two different temperatures, we are allowing for the rotating shaft and the housing to be at two different temperatures, which is more realistic than assuming them to be at the same temperature. What is the objective? To find out the temperature profile in this region. Okay. So, let us proceed with that. Flow between two parallel plates, one plate stationary, other plate moves at a constant velocity V p, till that it is same as the earlier description. Now, this condition is different, the plates are maintained at two different temperatures T naught and T h. Okay. So, now this is almost a recall slide, but with some more discussion. The first step is to find out the velocity profile. We already found out the velocity profile for this planar couette flow. So, in that sense it is recall, but some more discussion is required. So, let us proceed with that. What are the assumptions we made? It is steady state, and then we have only x component of velocity, there is no y component of velocity, there is no z component of velocity. And then we also said the x component of velocity does not vary in the z direction. And we use the continuity equation. And when we used these conditions V y equal to 0, V z equal to 0, we concluded that based on the continuity equation dou V x by dou x is equal to 0, meaning that the x velocity does not vary along the x direction. Based on this, we arrived that the x velocity varies only along the y direction. Now, till this the discussion is same, but to proceed further, which means that to solve for the velocity profile, we earlier used the Navier-Stokes equation. Now, to proceed further, we need to make an assumption. What is that? We are going to assume the viscosity is not a function of temperature. Now, question arises, why this assumption is required? Earlier, the two plates were at the same temperature, or we did not even mention that. Now, they are at two different temperatures. So, there is going to be a temperature profile here. Now, if viscosity varies, if viscosity is a function of temperature, then viscosity will also vary between the two plates, which means that first we will have to solve the energy balance, get the temperature profile, and then solve the linear momentum balance equation, including the variation of viscosity with space. So, by assuming viscosity as not a function of temperature, we have decoupled the momentum balance and energy balance equation. What does it mean? We can solve momentum balance separately, energy balance separately. Okay. Just to quickly recall, assumption of viscosity not to depend on temperature is required. Reason is temperature varies between the two plates. So, viscosity will also vary between the two plates if you assume it to depend on temperature, and which means that first we will have to solve the energy balance, then come to the momentum balance to solve for the velocity profile. But we are avoiding all the difficulties to make the problem simple by assuming viscosity is not a function of temperature, so that we can solve the momentum balance, energy balance separately. That is the first point. Now, what is the second point? Let us write down the Navier-Stokes equation and then we will see what is the other implication of assuming viscosity not to be a function of temperature. Okay, that is the Navier-Stokes equation. What is shown here are the last steps in the derivation of the Navier-Stokes equation. The right hand side alone is shown. In the right hand side only the viscous terms alone are shown, or the momentum flux terms are alone shown. Now, this was the step we had, and then we assumed viscosity as a constant, then we did simplification and arrived at this expression, which was in terms of the Laplacian of the velocity. But now, if viscosity is not a constant, then this expression is not valid. We will have to use this terms as such. Why is that? Because we assumed viscosity as a constant. What does it mean? Viscosity not varying with spatial location. We could take out the viscosity outside of this spatial derivative. But now, if we assume viscosity to depend on temperature, viscosity will also vary spatially. So, I cannot take it out and get this expression. I will have to solve the linear momentum balance equation with those terms as such. So, to simplify that as well, we have assumed the viscosity to be constant. Okay. So, two implications. One, decouples the momentum balance and energy balance equation, we can solve them separately. Second, to enable us to use the Navier-Stokes equation itself. Otherwise, we will have to take the form of linear momentum balance equation, which includes the spatial variation of viscosity. So, once we have justified this or made assumptions such that the Navier-Stokes equation can be used, then if you apply the usual simplifications, we arrived at this differential equation for the velocity profile, and if you solve, we get the linear velocity profile. But now, we should know the assumptions behind this equation. Okay, now, let us proceed towards solving the temperature profile. Let us write down the energy balance equation. Now, we will assume the density is constant and the thermal conductivity is also a constant. And so, this is the relevant energy balance equation. Once again, we looked at several levels of simplification. If you refer the particular discussion, we will find out that this is the equation applicable for the case of constant density and constant thermal conductivity. To quickly recall, thermal conductivity is constant, so we could take out and we could get a second order derivative for temperature. We got another term here, which was effect of temperature on density. Because we assumed density to be constant, that term does not appear. And left hand side we have capital DT by DT. Remember, because we are applying for fluids in motion. When you applied for solids, it was dou T by dou T. Okay, now, let us expand the substantial derivative, so that we can see how to simplify that, and right hand side same expression. Now, assumptions. Steady state So, dou by dou t equal to 0, there is only x component of velocity which I have already discussed. There is no component of velocity along y direction, z direction, already discussed. But now, to proceed further, we need to make more assumptions. What is that? Temperature does not vary along the flow direction, dou t by dou x is equal to 0. And then temperature does not vary along z direction. So, temperature will vary only along y direction. The whole idea is to make sure that there is only one spatial dependency, the temperature or velocity, we make it to vary along one direction, so that we result in a ordinary differential equation. For the present case, this assumption is called as fully developed temperature profile for the present case. So, now let us look at the left hand side. Because it is steady state, dou t by dou t is 0, and the next term we do have x velocity, but we assumed dou t by dou x to be 0. So, that term vanishes. Of course, here v y is 0. So, that term goes off, v as it is 0. So, that term goes off. So, the entire left hand side vanishes, or putting it the other way, we have made assumptions such that the substantial derivative vanishes. What is the reason? As I told you, we want to retain only one spatial dependency and make the problem simpler. Okay. So, right hand side we have k, and of course, there is no spatial variation with respect to x. So, second order derivative vanishes, similarly z direction. So, we are left out only with this term dou square t by dou y square. So, it becomes d square t by d y square equal to 0, because only one spatial dependency along the y direction. So, energy balance once again becomes very simple, but we should be aware of the assumptions which are made to arrive at this equation. So, now we will have to solve the second order ordinary differential equation. The temperature of both the plates are specified. So, T is equal to T naught at y equal to 0, T is equal to T h at y equal to h. So, we have d square T by d y square equal to 0, subject to these two boundary conditions, which have at this stage it is similar to the equation which you have seen for the case of slab. So, we get the same linear temperature profile, T is equal to T h minus T naught by h into y plus T naught. Okay. So, that is the temperature profile shown here, varying linearly from T naught to T h. So, same temperature profile, only the direction is different. Okay. There we considered a slab like this, here we considered two plates like this, but this temperature profile, as we have seen, has several assumptions behind it, Now, just to discuss, we have already discussed about this, just to I would say summarize. Suppose, if you have taken viscosity and thermal conductivity to depend on temperature, what will happen? Momentum balance, energy balance become coupled. First, you have to solve the energy balance equation for the temperature profile. Now, because thermal conductivity depends on temperature, we won't get a linear temperature profile. Okay. And then, once you know the temperature variation, you know the viscosity variation also along the y direction. So, include the dependency of viscosity and temperature. Viscosity directly depends on temperature, because temperature depends on y, viscosity indirectly depends on y. And then solve the momentum balance equation for the velocity profile, not the Navier-Stokes equation. So, that way it becomes very involved. That is why, to suit the level of this course, we have made several of the assumptions, and the profile I would say is not very interesting, just linear, and looks as if we have the same profile even when you have flow and when you have a solid, but we should keep in mind the assumptions here. Okay, so let us summarize. We looked at applications of the differential energy balance equation. I would say very, very simple application. One, to find out temperature profile in a slab, extended that to a furnace wall, also found out the heat flux. Next is to find out temperature profile in non-isothermal planar couette flow. So far we have been looking at planar couette flow, because it is a two different temperatures, we call it as the non-isothermal planar couette flow. Okay, let us summarize what we have discussed under differential energy balance equation. First looked at the chemical engineering applications of differential energy balance equation with respect to heat transfer equipments, mass transfer equipments and reactors. Then we derived the differential energy balance equation in terms of the total energy, internal kinetic and potential. And from that we got the equation in terms of internal and kinetic energy. Separately derived an equation for kinetic energy from linear momentum balance equation. From these two equations we got the differential energy balance equation in terms of internal energy. Then based on thermodynamic relations we expressed the equation in terms of enthalpy and in terms of temperature as well. We discussed the closure problem where we realized that the heat flux term has to be expressed in terms of temperature, more precisely temperature gradient. To close the energy balance equation, we discussed the constitutive equation, namely the Fourier's law of heat conduction, which says the heat flux is proportional to the temperature gradient including a negative sign. We discussed the analogy with Newton's law of viscosity. Using the Fourier's law of heat conduction, we express the energy balance equation completely in terms of temperature. We also simplified the differential energy balance equation to forms which we usually use. And finally, it had transient, convection, heat conduction terms. Looked at applications to find out temperature profile in a slab, a furnace wall, and then non-isothermal planar couette flow.